The Soybean School on RealAgriculture.com is brought to you by Pride Seeds, Safina Insecticide, and Cruiser Max Vibrance Beans.
Bernard Tobin on the Soybean School today, joined by Clare Kinlin from MacEwen Agricentre. Clare, how's it going?
Really good. We're having a fantastic spring down here so far. Definitely a much different picture than last year. We're rolling right along really well. Ideal soil conditions, just phenomenal.
Awesome. Hey, and one thing you're planting this year, like you have the last 5 and 7 years, is forage soybeans. Soybeans, you know, dairy production for feeding cattle, and something we don't hear a lot about, Clare. Tell us, why? Why would producers, you know, be planting soybeans for forage?
Yeah, we've been forced into it almost. We're not as blessed as the guys in Oxford County with the high-yielding alfalfa that they can cut 4 times a year and get great production out of. We really struggle with alfalfa in eastern Ontario, especially in our flatter ground, our clay ground. We cannot seem to get good high-yielding forage stands. And so the producers have been forced to try to find a protein alternative that they can grow on their own farm and to be able to keep the cow's bellies full.
Awesome. So obviously from a ration perspective, we'll talk about agronomics and the perspective, but it does fit into the protein portion of the ration.
Yeah, it's trying to replace the good quality alfalfa. I think most dairy farmers would say it's hard to beat really good alfalfa from a protein grown on the farm standpoint. But the forage beans are coming in a very close second. And we just cannot grow good alfalfa. Like on our flat clays, it's really a challenge to get production out of those. Because we want to get production per acre.
Yeah, you talked about production per acre. And I guess that starts with, you know, making a choice on variety, eh?
Yeah, variety selection is really critical, and no company is doing any testing to find out what's a better forage bean versus another forage bean. They just say, oh, these are long day beans, they work. That's not true. Some long day beans are really good for forage, and some are just like cutting trees. So you really have to, you want to find a good balance of maturity as well as palatability of it.
Now you mentioned long day. You're planting a lot, pretty long day beans, right?
Yeah, like we're growing from a grain standpoint, we're probably, most of our grain beans are from a 0.8 to a 1.2 maturity. Our forage beans are running a 2.7 to a 3.2 maturity on them. So wow. Quite a bit longer. We're growing a forage crop. We're not growing a grain crop. And that's a mindset we have to get through our heads as well as through the growers' heads, that by growing these longer day beans, we're getting more tonnage, but also from a harvestability standpoint. So one of the big mistakes with growing forage beans is the harvesting of them, that we wait too long. But when, you know, when we first started doing this, we were harvesting them sometime, you know, though MAFRA work was showing, wait till late R5, R6, and harvesting them in September just prior to corn silage. We have found we bumped that up. We can set our clocks to it. August 20th to August 25th is when we are cutting our beans for forages. And it's primarily as soon as they're done flowering.
Yeah.
Once the top node is done flowering, that's when we're in there.
Hey, I want to talk about some great flexibility at the end of the year then, but let's go back to agronomics. What about seeding rate? I'm assuming you got a big seeding rate here.
Yeah, we're pumping them. Like, don't plant them in 30-inch rows. You got a solid seed. Solid seed's ideal, but you can make 15-inch row work as well. 15s are actually pretty ideal because you do have to go through those fields a couple of times with fungicides and for weed control, but you want to make sure that you're growing forage, so the more biomass you can harvest, the better. So yeah, so and high rates, we're seeing 190 to 205,000 seeds per acre. So, you know, normal grain, we're down at 160 to 170,000. We're pushing that population higher because we're growing forage.
Yeah. Hey, and when you're up with that population, you got to be concerned about and managing white mold, especially in eastern Ontario, right?
Oh, yeah, we're the capital of white mold. If you haven't seen white mold come to eastern Ontario in the summertime, anytime after the 10th of August, you can start to see the bald heads out in the field. And we are starting to manage better for white mold in our grain soybeans. But it's still hit and miss. Some growers are still not onto the program that well. With forage beans, it's mandatory. I tell guys, if you're going to grow these forage beans, be prepared to spray them twice for white mold control. You just have to. You're growing them on generally pretty rich soil to start with, a heavy seeding rate, narrow rows, everything that wants to produce white mold, you set up for. So you really have to, and spray early. And actually, on one farmer, his white mold pressure is so high, the banks are so high, we're spraying three times there for white mold. And his yields have just gone through the roof, and his quality of feed. The big problem with white mold in the feed sample is palatability. Because you're harvesting dead plants.
Stalk.
They go slimy, they're thick, they're just woody. The cows just sort and put the stuff out to the side. So you want to make sure that you're protecting against that disease.
Talk about, harvest, how you harvest these things, Claire, and yield. You must be getting a really nice forage yield.
Yeah, it's about the same as growing a new seeding crop. Like, you're not hitting the roof. It's not a corn silage crop by any means, obviously. But you are getting a really good quality forage that you can utilize. They are wet when you cut them. It's pretty, you've generally got to let them lay for 2 to 3 days, sometimes even 5 days. But when you're doing that in August, you've got some really good drying conditions. You just lay them out flat. Let them dry, and then merge them and put them into the bunks. And it's ideal harvesting time. It's, the last, as I said, you can, August 20th, you better be out in the fields checking them, because probably within the week, you get five nice days or three nice days in the forecast, lay the beans down, get them in the bunk.
Yeah. Hey, Claire, final question for you, and that is, what's the potential here? Obviously, I know it's going to be a good fit for dairy farmers in this situation, but it sounds like everybody's sort of getting a handle on this one, and it's going to be part of, dairy operations in Eastern Ontario.
I absolutely, talking to our feed reps here at MacEwen's, we're fortunate enough that we have a feed business as well, so I work very directly with Lenny Van Loom. He's our ruminant manager. And he still likes forage in his ration. So I don't think it displaces 100% the forage, but you can manage that it will. There's some risk in that all your eggs are in one basket. So if you're counting on that forage stand to that alfalfa, you've got a couple of kicks at the can. With soybeans, you only got one crop and one harvesting window to get it off. So there is a risk to getting the crop in on time. But I would say that's farming. Will it replace hay in the ration 100%? I doubt it. It's nice to still have some forage, some haylage in with the forage beans. It makes some really, really nice feed.
Awesome. Hey, Claire, thanks for stopping by and joining us on the Soybean School. Appreciate it.
Very good. Thanks, Brad. Stay safe.